bank, you still get personalized customer service.
We have identity safe checking with LifeLock, identity theft protection.
You get personal mortgage lending to fit your needs now and in the future.
You get business banking with the latest technology, because saving you time saves you money.
At Council of Savings Bank, you get people who answer when you call and local employees who are actively involved in our community. Council of Savings Bank, hometown banking the way it used to be.
Think about that for a moment.
All right, everybody, please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to call the meeting to order, and before we start on the agenda, I'd like to read a proclamation for National Law Enforcement Day. City of Council Bluffs, Iowa, Office of the Mayor Proclamation, whereas concerns of Police Survivors, Inc., COPS, and partnering organizations united in support of law enforcement officers nationwide to promote National Law Enforcement Appreciation Day. In light of recent negativity directed towards law enforcement nationally, there is a need to show law enforcement officers that our citizens recognize the difficult and sometimes impossible career that they have chosen in public service to us all. And whereas each day 780,000 police officers across our country, 113 locally in Council Bluffs, pin their badge on and go to work knowingly that they may face extremely dangerous situations. What the public doesn't see is the toll law enforcement takes to keep our communities safe. On average, between 105 and 203 officers die in the line of duty each year. 50,000 officers are assaulted in the line of duty each year, and 14,000 officers are injured in the line of duty. Whereas being a law enforcement officer truly is a calling, you must be professional, courteous, caring, and yet be ready to protect the public at all times. You must be prepared to make life and death decisions at a moment's notice. You are subject to an amazing amount of abuse at times, but have to abuse this abuse is just part of the job. You do not have the liberty to express your emotions during many situations. And whereas law enforcement officers play such an integral part in our society, without law enforcement officers, chaos would reign. Have you ever thought about what you would do if you were in trouble, a car accident, a home invasion, an assault, and you did not have someone to call for help? No matter how much abuse law enforcement takes, they continue to do their job and they do it well. They are the guardians of our way of life and they deserve our support. And whereas each day we turn our officers and civilians of the Council Bluffs Police Department when crisis turn to our officers and civilians of the Council Bluffs Police Department when crisis arises, and we have no one else to turn to, and they always rise to the occasion, they are there for us. And finally, whereas this is an opportunity and the time to show our law enforcement officers that we, the citizens of Council Bluffs, recognize the difficult and sometimes impossible career they have chosen in public service to us all. For all these reasons and so much more, we would like to say thank you for everything our officers and civilian employees in the police department do every day to make our city a safe place to live. Therefore, I, Matt Walsh, Mayor of the City of Council Bluffs, does hereby proclaim yesterday, which is the official day, or Saturday, I'm sorry, January 9th, 2016, is National Law Enforcement Day in the City of Council Bluffs, Iowa. In doing so, our citizens can show their support for law enforcement in a number of ways, such as see a police officer and thank him, send a card of support to our police department, share a positive story about a positive law enforcement experience on social media, or ask children in our community to write letters to support law enforcement with the seal of the City of Council Bluffs. And thank you, officer. Appreciate it very much. All right. Do I have a motion for the consent agenda?
Motion to approve with the agenda as amended.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Tonight we have five public hearings. This is time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 16-04, approving the plan, specifications, form of contract, and cost estimate for Rivers Edge Subdivision Improvement Project Phase 3. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council in regards to this matter? Is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there a discussion?
Only just to note for the public that the cost of this particular project as envisioned, which is a street going around what is currently planned to be one office building, possibility of a second office building and parking structure. That street currently has an estimate of nearly $1.5 million.
Any other discussion?
It will at the same time also, bearing in mind its cost, it will also be a place for which public festivals and other events conducive to a good quality of life will be had right there at the foot of the pedestrian bridge. So there's two factors there to consider.
Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Nay.
This is the time and place for public hearings advertised on the matter of Resolution 16-05, determining an area of the city to be an economic development area, and that rehabilitation, conservation, redevelopment, development, or a combination thereof of such areas necessary in the interest of public health, safety, and welfare of the residents of the city, designating such area as appropriate for urban renewal projects, and adopting Amendment Number 4 to the Mid-America Urban Renewal Plan, formerly known as the MARCC, M-A-R-C-C Urban Renewal Plan, as proof of publication on file.
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone in the audience wishing to address the council in regards to this matter?
I mean, you changed your mind for a minute.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Deborah Peterson, 215 South Main Street, Council Bluffs, Iowa, appearing tonight on behalf of the Country Inn and Suites property and owner. And I want to start by letting you know that my comments tonight, I don't want to repeat them, but they do go to two or three different parts of the agenda. I will focus primarily in my first presentation on 4A or 4B, which we're talking about now, removing property from the MAC urban revitalization, and 5A, which is adding it to a different one coming up ahead of time. My client is very excited about this development, and they think it's a great improvement to the city, looking forward to have the recreational center there, looking forward to another hotel or two coming to the area. Their reason for concern to express to you is, although this is great for the city and the area down there which has stagnated, we have two primary issues. One is the Arena Way closing, and the other is fair competition in the area. And I will tell you right now, I'm not an expert on tax increment financing, but I do have a little understanding of that. So basically, I think one of the things that Mr. Gross said to you today was to be sure to coordinate things. And it looks to me like, reading the information, that the previous Amendment Number 3 was something that was done based on the hope of a retail destination shopping center or something on South 24th Street, which never came to fruition. So that amendment essentially was for naught. And so we want to make sure that this amendment doesn't do the same thing. So I think there's basically five things here that all need to kind of coordinate together. It's this ordinance, the ordinance to create the new one, the planned commercial development, and the sale and acquisition of the property, and approval of the development agreement. So I think that somehow, and Mr. Gross explained how you could waive certain things and defer certain things, and I'm sure that your attorney will advise you on that, but we would like to see such that all five come together at the same time, so we're not in a situation where you've taken property out of a district that didn't need to be taken out. So that's our concern on this particular item. We don't want something, so we want you to be cautious before you move forward in approving this. We understand that you're taking, you know, basically $2.6 million as a fixed base out of one taxing district and putting it into the other. But again, this is city land owned by the city, so it's really not affecting the taxes right now until it's sometime developed. Also, if I read the notes correctly, the city is looking at spending up to $4.5 million on the existing parking lot at that location. I'm not sure if that qualifies for the TIF benefits or not, if that's going to be city money and how that's going to work. When you get to 5A, that's the same issue, and it talks about the development agreement, and it says the city will consider requests for development agreements for projects which are unknown at this time. And I really think that what I heard this afternoon and what I've seen go through and what is in item 8, I really think there is already a project out there. I don't know how it came about or what the history of that is, but I think that is true. And I think to a certain extent you want to be cautious to not specifically tie your new district to this particular plan in case it ends up like Amendment 3 and doesn't come to fruition. The other question is basically this will allow the incentive to a new hotel. Occupancy rates at our hotels are relatively high and stable in the community. And so my client is welcoming a new hotel. We just want to be sure we're all on the same level playing field. As I understand, they'll be paying the same taxes as everybody else pays. However, their developer will be receiving or is potentially receiving a rebate, a loan, a grant, whatever, of the funds back. And once that development agreement is signed between the city and the developer, then the city has no control then over what the developer does with those funds, such as incent a hotel or someone else to not make the playing field level. So that's really our concern. We're not concerned about a hotel. We think, you know, another hotel or two or three, how many ever it takes, is fine. We just want to make sure everybody is on the same playing field. It's kind of like your discussion this afternoon on the parking meters. One person doesn't want it, one person does want it. We just all want to be on the same playing field with other hotels in the area as well. We will be participating in the Planning Commission meeting on the other urban revitalization plan, and we will be, you know, looking at the development agreement because we hope these are things that you will take into consideration and address for the businesses and entities that have invested money there already in that area. The other thing I'm going to talk about a little bit later is location. That's kind of an issue as to where the buildings are located, and I think the city actually has the control over that as part of a planned commercial development. You have control over where that stuff goes. And when you're looking at the actual location of those, I think that's something else that needs to be considered. The other things I have to talk about, the Arena Way and the parking and the structures themselves and location, really relate more to item 8C. So if you want me to continue now, I can, or if you want me to wait and get back up at 8C, I can do that. What's the council's pleasure?
Might as well. Yeah. All at once probably is easiest for you,
okay.
I imagine.
Okay, yep. Okay, on 8C, we're talking basically about the planned commercial plan down there. And again, this is where the city is going to have to sell property under the development agreement. So that's a whole nother process that you guys are all familiar with that you have to go through. So that affects the timing as well, too. So again, we encourage you, we urge you to coordinate those five steps so that everything comes together at the same time. One of the primary concerns is Arena Way being closed to vehicular traffic. Basically, what that does is that eliminates two accesses to our hotel. It also eliminates an additional access, vehicular access, to the Mid-America Center Convention Center. So everybody coming and wanting to drop their guests off at the door of the Convention Center will have to come down Arena Way from Mid-America Center Drive on the south, and you're going to end up in that little circle with nowhere to go and no way back out, because that's going to be closed to go through there. So we're very concerned about that. Our customers who come off of Interstate 80 generally come from that direction, not a problem. Our customers who come off of Interstate 29 are coming from the north and coming down through the plaza area there, and that's where they come in. And when there's events at the convention center, we've witnessed that people come from both directions and can get in and out. So basically, this is kind of a one way in, one way out is not really a good thing. And none of you would want that at your business to be stuck there. The other thing it does is we kind of laughed when they were talking about the shared parking arrangements, because that's kind of what goes on now. I kind of laugh because every time I go to the Mid-America Center, if there's something, I'm like, Matt, I'm not going to walk that far and pay money. I'll park in the Country Inn and Suites lot and then walk over to the Mid-America Center. So I know, because I learned that from Matt. But so, you know, that's what happens. People are, who said it this afternoon, we don't have a parking problem, we have a walking problem. And, you know, most of us are guilty of that. And, you know, Nate's in note to let's incent people to walk further, you know, it might work. But in this situation, we're already having a problem, and we're just amplifying that worse. You said today that business owners know their businesses best, and that's true, and we know our business, and we know we need two ways in and two ways out to accommodate our customers. This is also going to severely limit the access to parking. If you look at the new layout, it really doesn't make accessing the new parking convenient from anywhere. And if people do end up down in the little circle in front of the convention center, they're pretty much stuck there unless they go through a parking lot or go through the Country Inn and Suites parking lot or go back out the Arena Way Drive there. So we don't think that is a good option. The site development, we did not have a chance to look at their plans for the revisions they made on the landscaping. Again, I would encourage you to be flexible on that, because if this project doesn't work, whatever you have in there needs to work for the next project. So maybe being more general rather than so specific on that. Now, I know that the next word I'm going to use is not going to be very well liked around here today after an hour discussing parking, but it is a problem. It is a problem in the 100 block. It's a problem downtown. It's a problem everywhere, not eliminating the Mid-America Center. So basically what this project does is it eliminates parking and adds demand for parking. So if you look, I think it's on page 196 of your agenda items, the city has gone through their current calculations. Well, right now, as we sit without any development, we're about 600 and some spaces short there for the anticipated need. Is it an issue? You know, as was discussed this afternoon, probably when there's the hugest event at the Mid-America Center, probably. Otherwise, do we work around it? Yeah. Do people park over in Horseshoe and park in Country Inn and park everywhere? Yes, that happens. But then if you look at the chart, then it says if we do this and allow these structures and remove the parking and add the parking, when we get done, we are 2,600 parking spaces short. And I guess we're kind of just sitting here shaking our heads wondering why we would make a different definition for this development as opposed to anybody else. Any private developer coming along doing this would have to comply with those requirements. So I think we're short 2,600, and that's just too many, number one. Number two, they've given you a letter that says, well, we think 500 is what we need. Well, our statute or our ordinance says 1,400. But even if you look at their letter saying they really only need 500, you'll see that they have 320 in the sports facility at one time, and 180 for other stuff going on, like yoga, karate, whatever else they have going on. But what they failed to consider in that calculation is that those 320 courts, kids on the court or cars on the court, are flipping over every 55 minutes, as they tell you. Well, that doesn't mean 320 cars in, wave a wand, they're out, and another 320 are in. So at any one given time at 20 till, If the games start on the hour at 20 till, you have 640 cars to accommodate, plus the 180. So we're a little shorter than what they have estimated for you. So we're thinking that should be 820, and regardless of what it is, it's still short of what the city calculation requires. I did not attend the Planning Commission meeting, and I don't believe their minutes are available yet, and I was unable to access their old agenda items because it's a new year and the archives weren't working. But I note that that was not a unanimous vote at the Planning Commission. I do not know the basis for that. And the 600 shared with the casino, basically that's kind of what's going on right now. And again, that's the walking problem we have. People aren't going to walk that far. And there was some reference to some city-owned property down by Bass Pro. Once again, that's a longer walk, number one. And number two, that is city-owned property. So if that's going to be used in the development, we would suggest let's put it in right now. There was a comment, let's do this to start with. Well, let's not do this to start with. Let's do the project right, totally, and go forward from there. And then the location. The four-story hotel is going to block the view of the Mid-America Center substantially. And the sports complex, we're guessing, is somewhere between 3 to 4 stories. It's not really stories, but height-wise. And it's same. And there's... plan totally interrupts the traffic pattern which has been established down there. My client is of the position that this should actually be on the north side of the Mid-America Center because that area does not provide any convenient parking right now for anything. It would also allow access from the north-south street that goes into the casino. And it would make the more convenient parking for everybody if the field house was moved over to the north and then the new hotel be moved over. The other benefit for the hotel is it would be able to be easily adjoined to the Mid-America Center, which I realize is a goal of the developer. So they'll be much closer. And one of the comments of the engineer or architect from Kansas today was that they're concerned about safety of families, and that's why they need to close Arena Way. Well, if this was moved over to the north side and the parking shifted and the hotel shifted, then those families would never have to cross the street even if we left Arena Way open. So that takes care of that issue. He also mentioned that it really helps the aesthetics of the building. Well, it might help the aesthetics of their building, but it certainly doesn't help the aesthetics of the Mid-America Center building the way it sits right now. So again, we're supportive of the project, but we think that you have the control over the location, you have the control over Arena Way, and you have the control over the developer to determine to incent or not incent these businesses. Now the field house might be a different deal because they don't have a direct competitor that I'm aware of in this area, but the hotel is coming in and going to compete with a number of other hotels, not just my client, but a number of other hotels in the area. My client is very interested in this and very concerned about the closing of Arena Way and the level playing field. Gary Friedenbach and Lynn Friedenbach are both here if you have questions for them. I realize that we want to try to be on a short schedule tonight, so if you have questions, I'm happy to answer them later in the week, because I realize that there's a whole lot of things that have to be done before this goes anywhere. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you for your indulgence. I ask that my comments be recorded on this public hearing on the 5B resolution and the 8C resolution as well.
I'm glad you're in favor of it.
Thank you.
It's been longer. Hey, I actually had talked to your clients about the closing of Arena Way, and so I took a trip down there. I told your clients that just for the very things that I said today, I sneak, I cheat, I go the shortest route, and the shortest route for me is One Arena Way, and I am the only person ever on that street that I know of. So when your client said, well, people use that to get to my hotel, I said, really? So I took a trip down there. There is no convenient way to get off 23rd Avenue to get to One Arena Way. And so if you're directing your customers to go that route, it would take you much more direction to get them to One Arena Way rather than tell them to drive towards Bass Pro and come around the other way. So I find that argument maybe not substantiable because, again, it just you have to come in on a road, you have to turn on a road to get to a road to get to that road, and so it's really not the most direct, easiest route to get there. And I don't think we're going to close the route to the parking lot that you kind of indicated we would by the front of the convention center because people do have to access that parking lot. But your point's well taken about the position of the building, although it is to the north. I guess you're talking to the northeast more maybe would be a better location. But one of the things that we initially did was to not work directly with the project. We worked with the developer, and the developer, if this passes, gets development incentives that they can apply as they see appropriate. So
I did have just one question, if I could, and that is that you discussed the timing, making sure that all the pieces were coordinated, and you also mentioned that we're basically establishing a TIF district island that exists in a existing TIF district, and I ask questions about the impact, you know, timing. If we move forward on this portion, how's this position us to make decisions later on down the road? Since the TIF district and the ordinance are going to require three readings, do you feel that you're in a position to come back and come up with some amended proposals and meet with Iowa West and the city and try and put something together by
TIF district reading? Has absolutely no effect on our client.
The TIF district doesn't have any direct effect on my client, but I think all five of these things go together, and are we willing to sit down and talk and kind of come up with ideas that we think are better? Yeah. Do we think our ideas are better? Absolutely. Are they positive? Who knows, you know? But, yes, are we willing to provide input? Absolutely. My clients are more than willing to work with the city, Iowa West, whoever, to try to work this out for everybody's benefit in the area down there and make this the best possible investment down there.
Obviously, the result will come at the time that we have the business plan put forward, and then we're starting to make decisions on whatever those financial incentives are. That's going to help determine whether or not the project goes forward. So,
and we're not opposed to financial incentives per se. We're opposed to them going to make a competing business have an advantage over our existing business, because I think everybody's going to pay the same tax. It just depends on where the money goes. If it ends back up in the taxpayer or not. Yes, we'll participate, and if you have any questions, you can direct them to me or to my clients directly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The hotels that are down there now that are in that TIF district, did any of those get incentives at the time? I wasn't on the council at the time. Do you know?
Any of the what?
You know, that it was already
existing
in the TIF.
Hotels get TIF benefits? Not to my knowledge.
I don't think so, because everybody in the room is shaking their head. No.
Wasn't there a land?
You got your land free, didn't you?
I thought there was like a reduced from what I had, and I think.
I can check into that. And
because I thought there was something with the land for some of it that was sold at a reduced rate. Wasn't that what it was, Matt?
I don't
remember.
It was,
they're there saying was no.
That doesn't sound reduced.
Some of it's, they had really high expectations, some of them. I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else wish to address the council? Is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve the resolution.
Second.
Is there any discussion?
I think this is, I recognize the concerns. On the whole, though, I don't think it'll surprise anyone that area has not exceeded expectations. It has not taken off to the degree that everyone hoped that it would. And this is an opportunity for non-taxpayer money to bring in our very first full-service hotel, a facility for young people so that they, right now our competition, they all go to Omaha because we don't have any facility like that, so our money leaves our town. It'll help bring a shot in the arm to an area that the taxpayers have put a heck of a lot of money in, and having more people in that area in the end will only help every business down there. And I know change is difficult, and we get used to the way some things are, but if that area keeps going as it's going, I just don't see how the taxpayers can continue to pump and lose money in an area, continually lose money at their expense every year, so that it can stay. I mean, some of the buildings don't even have floors in them. They were built and they're still dirt floors. That area is not, and I'm certainly not talking about the establishment of Deb Peterson's clients. That's certainly a very well done facility. I don't mean to imply otherwise. But that area, something's got to happen. And this is a plan, again, not at taxpayer expense. And it's on the whole a phenomenal idea. And so to say no to that, I need to know what we would do different. And doing nothing and keeping it the way it is now in the hopes that something better will come along just doesn't seem prudent for the taxpayer.
I think the comments are well taken. And what we're discussing with this particular resolution is the modification of the urban renewal plan. And this would be the Fourth Amendment. And as the councilman points out, the progress made based upon the prior amendments has been less than what it had been hoped at the time. Mm-hmm. So this is a necessary first step to keep the discussion going and begin to work this project further and keep it on track. So I think it's a prudent move, but I also question the other aspects and hope for there to be additional fine-tuning and discussion on those to make sure that we keep everybody on an even keel, that we aren't picking favorites, and that we make this as successful of a business district as we possibly can.
Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. This is time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 16-06, which authorizes disposal of city property legally described as Lot 3 in the east 22 feet of Lot 4, Block 25, Bryan and Clark's addition. Is approved publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council in regards to this matter? Is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. This time in place for a public hearing is advertised on the matter of Resolution 16-07, authorizing disposal of city property legally described as the southeast 30 feet of Lot 8, Block 4, Stutzman's First Edition. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council in regards to this matter? Is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. This is time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 16-08, which authorizes disposal of city property legally described as Lot 11 in the north half, vacated alley abutting Lot 32 Central Subdivision. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council in regards to this matter? Could you please give your name and address for the record?
I'm Sherry Scott, 21910 Wildflower Avenue. I work at NeighborWorks Home Solutions, and I got in charge of with this veteran home program. It's a pilot program. We're trying to make it a program here in Council Bluffs, unprecedented, never done before. And so if you have any questions that I can answer.
No, I was sharing a lovely discussion that we had about some of the projects earlier. So Thank you.
I see. Yes, I watched on the TV today, so I come.
I think one of the questions that came up in the study session was, were there qualifications? Was it just a veteran could buy the house? Was it a veteran that had an income qualification, had a disability qualification?
As far as the veteran part of the qualification, that will come from Darlene at the VA office. The financial part I will help with. This will be a mortgage-free home to the vet, but we want to make sure that that vet that goes in there is able to maintain the home taxes and just regular home maintenance. But we don't want somebody to make this deserving vet go in and lose the home. So all of that, yes, we are working together with the VA for that.
Am I right to understand that that there's contemplated a 10-year forgiveness schedule of the mortgage? In essence, every year that the veteran lives in the home, 10% of the gift of the home will be forgiven. So just to encourage that, if there's a sale quickly, which I don't expect, but if there were, yes, that would discourage that, so that it would stay in the hands of a deserving veteran as opposed to being a windfall.
Yes, sir. And that's something we're trying to eliminate, all those little pitfalls.
Yes.
Because we don't want a veteran to go in and say, oh, yeah, here I got a $100,000, $150,000 home. I can just sell it. And so that all of those, because we do that with our own clients now, mm-hmm, when they get money from the city. So it would be the same way. We would probably do a 10-year plan, and each year it would be 20% or however many until it goes down.
And I am familiar generally with your regular plan. I guess I should say I'm on the board of your organization.
Okay, yes.
But of course, it being a public service position, there's no personal conflict. But I did want to point out, I wanted to give you an opportunity to explain that you do have an adequate process in place by which you ensure that people are able to afford,
yes,
it and know how to do it if they need financial literacy, I suppose,
yes,
for lack of a better word.
Yeah, and also in our own program, we make the city, it's just part of a deal.
Yeah.
They have to go through a home ownership course,
mm-hmm,
and we would like that veteran to also do that. It's a 12-hour course, and they have to get the certificate. And that explains all the things of being a homeowner.
So
yeah, we do. We will incorporate a lot of our things, but we won't. The VA will choose the veteran. We just want to make sure that veteran is able to maintain the home.
And
thank you.
Somebody's been busted.
And just so you know, folks, particularly at home, can understand this. The idea in the main is this provides a veteran a deserving place to live,
yes,
at no cost to them.
Mortgage free.
Yeah, and
it would be the maintenance cost,
taxes,
and
fair enough.
So we would just want to make sure all of that is, like I said, we don't want to put this deserving vet in there. I'm a veteran, and so we don't want them to fail. We want this to be that little boost to help them come back into the community and be great.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
I've got a partial score, 23. It's an old joke. 23 is partial score. Anything from the council? Do we have a motion yet on the table?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second? Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Madam Clerk.
Ordinances on first consideration. Ordinance 6259. Amending ordinance numbers 5607, 5905, and 6013, providing that general property taxes levied and collected each year on all property located within the amended Mid-America Center Urban Renewal Area, formerly known as the MARC Urban Renewal Plan, in the City of Council Bluffs, County of Pottawatomie, State of Iowa, by and for the benefit of the State of Iowa, City of Council Bluffs, County of Pottawatomie, Council Bluffs School District, and other taxing districts be paid to a special fund for the payment of principal and interest on loans, monies advanced to, and indebtedness, including bonds issued or to be issued, incurred by the city in connection with the amended MAC Urban Renewal Area Amendment Number 4 to the Mid-America Center Urban Renewal plan, formerly known as the MARC Urban Renewal Plan.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there a discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance 6260, amending the zoning map as adopted by reference in section 15.02.070 by rezoning the properties legally described as lots 2 through 6 and 10 through 15, block 13, Beer subdivision from C2 commercial to R3 low density multifamily residential district as defined in chapter 15.10, setting a public hearing for January 25th, 2016 at 7 p.m.
Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the ordinance and setting a public hearing for January 25th, 2016 at 7 p.m.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance 6261, amending the zoning map as adopted by reference in section 15.02.070 by rezoning blocks 75 and 76, Railroad Addition and vacated South 20th Street between 27th and 28th Avenues from C2 Commercial District to I2 General Industrial District as defined in Chapter 15.21, setting a public hearing for January 25th, 2016 at 7 p.m.
Move the ordinance and set public hearing for January 25th at 7 p.m.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
I would like to hear, and hopefully we'll get a chance at the public hearing to hear from the applicant, with regard to the question of the difference between two different zoning types, industrial one or industrial two, some concerns in the one they're seeking. And I look forward to hearing their answers.
Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance 6262, amending the zoning map as adopted by reference in section 15.02.070 by rezoning lots 1 through 6, including the vacated alley adjacent block 12, Bryant and Clark subdivision, from I-1 Light Industrial District to R-3 Low Density Multifamily Residential District as defined in Chapter 15.10 and setting a public hearing for January 25th, 2016 at 7 p.m.
Move the ordinance and set public hearing for January 25th at 7 p.m.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance 6263, amending Chapter 15.23, off-street parking, loading, and unloading by amending Section 15.23.030, design standards, subsection 4, parking provisions for recreational vehicles and vessels.
Is there a motion?
Move the ordinance and set public hearing.
Someone require public hearing.
Yep.
Oh, excuse me. Move the ordinance.
Move the ordinance to second consideration of the motion. Is there a second? Motion dies for lack of a second. Madam Clerk.
Ordinance 6264, repealing ordinance number 5923, which approved the tax increment financing district for the Manawa Business Park Phase 2 Urban Renewal Area.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance 6265, amending ordinance 5708 by amending Chapter 9.36.020, which designated streets and parking lots as parking meter zones.
Motion to approve taking the ordinance to second consideration.
Second.
Is there a discussion?
We had considerable discussion of this at at the study session, and there were a number of good comments and inputs made on both sides of the issue, and what we wanted to do is to make sure that discussion which has been initiated continues to move forward. So with the expectation that there will be some modifications to the ordinance and to the process, we wanted to keep this on track, move it to second consideration, and move from that point.
I am going to vote in favor of moving it to second reading, but would not support it in its current form as discussed today. I think that we do need to continue the conversation, but so I'm not voting in favor of the way it's written right now, but only to move it to second.
I want to hear more information about potential ways, the aims, ways to achieve the aims, and ways to avoid any unintended consequences. So I look forward to continuing the discussion, so I'll vote to move it to second reading.
Anyone else? Bruce?
Bruce Kelly, 864 McKenzie Avenue. I had a few questions to ask about this. This is basically an for the First Street area, isn't it?
It's for anywhere in the city that has
anywhere
parking.
In the city.
Yep.
That means about like the parking lot behind the First Street and everything else like that, about taking out the meters or stuff like that. Didn't we just the city just revamp that area within the last couple of years?
Yep.
And it cost us to do that, right?
It did.
We maintain that by snow removal and maintenance for the property, right?
That's correct.
If we take out these meters, what money is going to be used to maintain that and keep it up? Because part of this parking meter money goes into the general fund, which is taxpayers' money that has to pay for the removal and maintenance of this property. That is one of the reasons why we rebuild it and redone it, and we have to maintain it, we have to stripe it, we have to mow it, we have to remove snow. And if there's any damage down there, we have to fix it. So this money that's just from these parking meters isn't just because it's an inconvenience for people. This money is to maintain and support that parking lot and all the parking that is in this area. If you take out parking on First and Broadway, then who says that these people down here don't want their all the parking meters, all of this, because they have businesses too that they want support. So you have two deals. Either we remove all the parking meters in town and don't worry about it, and then we lose that money and everything else. Yes, we have parking meters personnel that go around. They do not just do parking meters. They do where in front of fire hydrants, they drive out to all the malls and everything for handicap and everything else. This is just not a job. These people will lose their job if we don't have them. And that's an income. I don't know if the all of the $64,000, is that for the tickets that are just wrote for parking meters, or is this for the tickets that also involve the handicap tickets?
I don't have the answer to that for you. The number that I had was the parking meter fees plus fines.
So this probably doesn't
minus the cost of the employee personnel costs and not the maintenance, not the lighting, not the repair.
And see, that's one thing, you know, all of a sudden there's people that, and then it's going to end up being a campaign issue. Who supports not having these and everything else? And then you're going to have to, the way I understood it in the paper, every year you have to revise this. That means this is time and stuff out of your agendas for something that really should be just left the same. It's worked for, 50 years? What's, you know, and it's, you know, you don't fix what's not broken.
Thank you.
Appreciate the input.
Any additional input from the council? All right, we have a motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Partial score 37.
Ordinance is on second consideration. Repealing ordinance which approved and or amended a tax increment financing district, Ordinance 6257, repealing ordinance numbers 5662, 5858, and 5924, which approved and amended the tax increment financing district for the Manawa Business Urban Renewal Area, and Ordinance 6258, repealing Ordinance Number 6134, which approved the tax increment financing district for the Nebraska Avenue Urban Renewal Area.
Motion to approve A1 and A2.
Second.
Is there a discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Motion to waive third.
Is there a second? Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Sorry. Ordinance is on third consideration. Ordinance 6253, amending the zoning map as adopted by reference in section 15.02.070 by rezoning lots 378 through 382 and the south half of the vacated alley abutting Belmont Addition from R1 Single Family Residential District to C2 Commercial District as defined in Chapter 15.15.
Motion to concur with staff recommendation.
Second.
Is there a discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Just a clarification on that. Right. Staff recommendation was to deny, was it?
Yes.
Yes.
Second, concur with that?
Yes.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Ordinance is amending Chapter 13 and 15 of the 2010 Council Bluffs Municipal Code referencing electrical fence regulations, security, and permit fees. Ordinance 6254 amending Chapter 15.13 definitions by adding Section 15.03.271A fence electrical security fence. Ordinance 6255 as revised amending Chapter 15.24 supplement use and site development regulations by amending section 15.24.040 fence regulations to include and address fence electrically charged security, and ordinance 6256 amending chapter 13.16 electrical code by creating a new section 13.16.4485 entitled fence electrically charged security.
Motion to approve B1, B2, and B3.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Same sign.
Resolutions. Resolution 16-09, authorizing the mayor to execute a reimbursement agreement with the Board of Waterworks Trustees in connection with ICAP project, East Broadway realignment at Canesville Boulevard project.
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 16-10, authorizing the mayor to execute an agreement with Earhart Griffin and Associates for engineering services in connection with the East Manawa Sewer Rehab Phase 5 project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
I will be abstaining on this, and for the reason that my husband is employed by that company. And so in order to make sure that there's no view that there's a conflict of interest, I won't be voting on that.
Any other discussion? Roll call vote.
Head.
Aye.
Ringenberg.
Aye.
Sandow.
Aye.
Watson.
Aye.
White.
Abstain.
Resolution 16-11, amending the plan commercial development plan for Lot 1, Hotel Plaza at the Mid-America Center, being a replat of Lot 7, Bluffs Vision Subdivision.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
Comments made earlier tonight concerning placement and parking, I think, are well taken, but I think it's important at this time, for all the reasons that we've discussed so far, to keep this consideration moving forward. There's nothing in this particular development plan that can't be reversed at a later point in time as opposed to the ordinance. So with that in mind, I'll vote to approve.
Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 16-12, repealing the Manawha Business Park Phase 2 Urban Renewal Plan and area.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there a discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 16-13, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to enter into an agreement with Miko Henning Contracting Incorporated for the River's Edge Phase 2 project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there a discussion?
Just to note that that this particular contract we anticipate is a little over $6 million. When we began discussion of this with the amendment to the urban renewal plan back in October 2014, noted that the overall infrastructure costs for this particular development were estimated at the time to be about $7 million. In September 2015, we approved a contract for $4 million in infrastructure, and we also have the additional resolution earlier tonight that commits another $1.5 million. So the urban renewal plan projection for infrastructure costs has grown from $7 million to $11.5 million.
And you're mixing apples and oranges because they're two different projects.
They're all part of the...
No, they're not. One project is a parks project. One is an economic development, residential development project.
So the urban renewal plan, the overall infrastructure cost for the entire project.
I believe you're incorrect. But
I understood that to be for the infrastructure, not the park area. So if I misunderstood that, well, my bad. But it was set out as infrastructure. I assume to be roads and sewer and water. So I would be surprised if that had included the cost of the parks, too. I thought that was separate.
Building is normally infrastructure, but okay.
Any other discussion? All those in I'm sorry, do we have a motion? We do, I think.
Yes.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Nay.
Resolution 16-14, authorizing the mayor to sign a memorandum of understanding with the Iowa West Foundation, which provides financial assistance for phase two of the River's Edge Park project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 16-15, City Council support of the Home Base in Iowa Initiative.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion.
I want to thank a number of bodies and individuals that have entered down this this process on consideration of establishing Council Bluffs in Pottawatomie County as a home-based Iowa community and county. I think that this is a little bit unique in Iowa in that we are kind of proposing a joint city-county initiative, and what this does, as was noted in the nonpareil, is that this creates kind of a much larger team project where the Chamber of Commerce, thanks to their willingness to step forward on this, they help bring businesses together as prospective employers for veterans. Also helps build a package of incentives. The state has laid the foundation with a number of state tax incentives. We hope to build upon that with some county incentives. And then there's some smaller things that we can do at the community level that don't even involve taxpayer money. But this helps provide incentives through the business community to help connect veterans, help them understand that Council Bluffs wants them here to work, to live, and helps grow employment opportunities for veterans. And I think that that's a very positive thing for the business community. I think as Mr. Munt and the other communities and counties have done this, will tell you that veterans make some of the most dependable hardworking parts of the workforce that an employer could hope to find. And so so I thank the Chamber of Commerce and our local Veterans Affairs Office, the County Board, and the city for helping to bring this together. This is a beginning of a process that will probably take several months to complete, and I'm just thrilled to see the level of enthusiasm brought together by the community on this so far. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 16-16, confirming the appointment of John Finnegan as the city's representative to engage in collective bargaining negotiations with the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
City Council action on request for waiving rental inspection late fees.
I'd make a motion to waive late fees to the end of January, January 31st, just due to it being a new ordinance and people not being aware that the date had changed, because it really was like March. So for this year only, and letters to go out with those so that people understand this won't happen again next year, but it is in consideration that people just weren't aware of the date change that these were due.
And I'd second that. Then on discussion, if I may, it was as said at the time and meant, it was never intended, this ordinance, to raise revenue but to raise safety. And this is a limited exception for folks that had gotten used to being able to, in essence, you could be up to about 3 months late, as I recall, without a late fee. And so that became the general course of business. And so this is a major change from that. So this is a one-time exception to allow folks so they don't get stuck with considerable late fees. And these are folks trying to comply with the law. It's a one-time exception, and it meets all of the, doing this meets all of the original reasons for this law. So, and alleviates many of the concerns that were raised against it. So I support it fully.
And I'd like to offer my thanks to the inspection office as well as to Mr. Wade for helping to bring forth this proposal. I think it's well taken.
Any other discussion? And so, point of clarification, if you are a landlord and you have not yet registered your property, you have until the end of January, the last day of January, to do that without a penalty. And so I'm going to encourage you to get your rental registration completed.
Just for this year. And if I may clarify, in person by the close of business or postmarked by that day to avoid another kicking the can down the road, so to speak, of creating yet another problem of when the deadline is, people should know. It postmarked that day or physically in the office by the close of the building division is it. And I'm sorry it was your motion, but if I may make that friendly amendment.
Absolutely.
All right.
All right. Is there a second to the amendment? Or were you the second?
I guess.
To the amendment. Oh.
I'll make the amendment.
And I'll second it.
And he'll second it.
All right.
It. We're good to go.
So any further discussion? We're voting on the amendment. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. The resolution as amended. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Applications for permits and cancellations, 9A and B inclusive.
Motion to approve 9A and B inclusive.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Madam Clerk, any requests from citizens to be heard?
While we're doing that, can we get a latest score from Dick?
I think it was Ryan earlier.
Partial score 47.
Mr.
Roger, you'll get used to this. Bruce Kelly, 864 McKenzie Avenue, bike trail, fairway over the hill.
Got it.
I'm with you.
Old tide roll. 7-7. No, all right. Anything from the council? Hearing none, thank you all and have a great night.
At Council Plus Savings Bank,
you get personalized customer service like nowhere else, like our travel club.
Come see us, bank with us, and travel with us. Council Bluffs Savings Bank, hometown banking the way it used to be.
The Mid-America Center is the Heartland's premier entertainment and convention center. December 17th through the 19th, local teams go head-to-head on the hardwood at the Mac Shootout. Then see America's favorite traveling train show at the Train Expo January 2nd and 3rd. And the action doesn't get any bigger than Monster Jam January 9th and 10th. Over at the Convention Center January 10th, there's endless inspiration at the Wedding Essentials Bridal University. Remember, the Mac offers free parking for all events. Tickets, information, and more at midamericacenter.com.